C-sharp as a language is fairly old, 23 years and counting, and so is .NET. With so much baggage we carry from the old days, and with so much background noise, it is no wonder many C-sharp programmers are confused by some of the features and even entire libraries. In this video, I will draw your attention to three features of C-sharp and .NET, which some programmers never use, not because C-sharp is bad, but because there are so many C-sharp programmers who fail to understand it. That is tragic. It needs not be that way. So stay with me, hear me out. Misconception number one. Records are useful as DTOs and nothing more. I hear that a lot. I mean, a lot. But that is blatantly wrong, and I will now show you why. This is a record. This is a DTO. You can use them interchangeably in most scenarios where you need a DTO. So yes, a record can be used as a DTO. A common DTO is a tad more manageable if the accent is on serialization and deserialization. But that is where all further similarities end, because records have a few other features that DTOs don't have. A record is immutable by default, which means its hash code is derived from the values it contains. It also comes with value-typed semantics. DTOs have reference equality. I'm talking about the default behavior of both. You can override all this, but that would require effort. Immutability and value-typed semantics mean you can use a record as a key, while you cannot use a DTO that way. Being a value, a record will not contain an ID. That is what we put into entities to track their lifetime. A record can have some key value, but it would not understand it as its own key. Same with a DTO. If it transfers an entity, then it would naturally contain an entity's ID. Last but not least, you will avoid placing collections onto a record. That would violate the record's value-typed semantics. That constraint is not relevant to DTOs. The bottom line is that records are much more than DTOs. Anyone who still believes that records are only DTOs needs more education. If you wish to learn more about .NET and C# programming, then subscribe to my channel. There are many videos where I'm explaining how C# really works and should be used. You can also support my channel by becoming a sponsor, visit my Patreon page, and join the growing community there. That will give you access to more resources, discussions, and trainings. You can also join my Discord channel where you can take part in discussions and learn more. Now to misconception number two. LINQ is slow. I hear that a lot too. And I hear it from two kinds of people. Those who never measured performance and those who don't know what performance means. Let's clarify where the performance of LINQ comes from. LINQ applies to sequences, but collections are also sequences. There is, however, a gross difference between a ready-made collection of objects and a lazy evaluated sequence of those same objects. You need to know how iterating through a lazy evaluated sequence differs from iterating through a collection. Here I'm instantiating many relatively large objects and storing them into a collection. The size of this collection is by one item over 8 megabytes, and that will cause issues on a CPU with an 8 megabyte large cache. The last object will cause eviction of the first one. Now I iterate through the objects, paying for the first one to be brought back from memory. That will evict another poor item, which I will have to wait for again once iteration comes to it. You get the picture. I'm destroying performance by fetching all the data up front. With the LINQ and the lazy evaluated sequences, we create an object, process it, and leave it to the garbage collector. Data locality is improved, giving an excellent opportunity for the CPU cache to shine. Hence the rule, measure first, make conclusions later. You might be surprised to see how fast some LINQ queries are when you compare them to alternatives. The second half of the story is to know what it means to say something is slow. Where do the data come from? Where do the results go? Take the data from the database and wait at least a millisecond for them. process the data either way, that might take 10 microseconds, then send them across the Pacific, adding at least some 50 milliseconds at the speed of light. Let's put the data at the back of the envelope. Here is the timeline of our web response. I have a message for anyone who would invest in optimizing 0.02% of the execution time. Go for it and never look back. That will slow them down. I will repeat this. Don't be ignorant. Everyone must learn programming before doing programming. Subscribe to my channel and learn from other videos I have made about C# and .NET programming. And again, join me on Patreon and Discord for more discussions about C# programming. You can ask questions there. Related to the previous examination on LINQ, there comes the third misconception I hear almost daily. Some programmers are very particular when they say, "I won't use immutable design because it is slow." Spoiler alert, I will now tell you the root cause of why some programmers abstain from using immutable design. That is their way to hide the fact that they have no clue about functional programming. So let me explain. In an immutable model, you cannot change an object after instantiation. Instead, you create a new object with all its state copied except what you wish to change. That is called non-destructive mutation. Is it a slow process? No. In fact, it is as fast as calling a function. It is so because we don't really copy any state. We copy references to other objects, which is as cheap as passing those references to function parameters. We don't avoid calling methods on the grounds that it will slow our program down. Some say that this process, if not slow, is costly as it creates many short-living objects that require expensive garbage collection. That is another misconception, this time stemming from not knowing how garbage collection works. It takes time to deal with the living objects, not the dead ones. The garbage collector follows references to discover the living objects, then does a potentially costly memory-to-memory copying to relocate them near the beginning of the heap. Guess what? Garbage collector never touches a short-lived object because it is unreachable. Deleting all, and I will emphasize all short-living objects from memory, is as costly as changing the value of the end of the heap pointer, a single memory location assignment. And that brings us to the very beginning of this topic. Is immutable design slow? No, it is not when done right. Oh, when done right. Alright, that is the part which I kept for the end. Once you master immutable design, you will attain other benefits. A predictable state will help you write expressive code, reducing the number of bugs by an order of magnitude. Immutability will promote composable objects and composable methods, helping write way shorter and more flexible code than the mutable counterpart. It all takes knowledge and education, let's face it. I will tell you this straight. Suppose that you are avoiding functional design in .NET out of fear of low performance. When I hear that, then I know something about you. I know you have never seen how functional designs perform, nor have you seen what comes packed together with them, such as a wonderful expansion of your design capabilities when you use functional designs. Did I poke you in the eye? Good if I have. I would rather see all C# and .NET programmers start appreciating the functional capabilities of C#. You can learn a lot about those capabilities on my channel. Subscribe and start by watching this informative video first.